gonna come and break the bread of life with us this morning. So come on, let's give a God a hand. I hear a message this morning. Hallelujah. Come on, Stacy. Hallelujah. Is God not good? And all the time? Amen. Let's put our hands together for God one more time.
Yeah.
see this thing the way it is. Hallelujah. Our message today is going to be about sight. Hallelujah. Turn with me, if you will, to Genesis, the 13th chapter. Genesis, the 13th chapter. And we're going to look down at the 14th verse. And the Lord said to Abram, after Lot had separated from him, lift your eyes now and look from the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, and westward. For all the land which you see, I give to you and your descendants forever. I want to draw your attention to verse 14. The latter part says, look from the place where you are. He said, and 15, for all the land which you see, I will give to you. I want to speak to you today from the subject, what you can see, you can have. You may be seated in His presence. Father, I come before you this morning, God, thank you for this day you made. Father, I thank you for your mercy and your grace, your love and your kindness. I thank you, Lord, that you're patient and that you're long-suffering, willing not that any should perish. I thank you for your hedge of protection that you place about us. I thank you how you shield us from the hand of the enemy, how you encamp your angels about us to protect our minds from the fiery darts that the enemy throw at us, Lord. I thank you right now for being in your presence, God. Father, I decrease that you would increase in me, God. Not what I would have to say, God, but what you would say through me. I'm just a vessel, a tool, an instrument in your hand, God, to carry out your word. Lord, so use me today, God. In Jesus' name, let us say amen. 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 I want to talk this morning about vision. Vision. Vision is probably one of the greatest of our necessities. Vision work together with faith. I don't believe you can actually have faith without vision. We know the Bible teaches that faith cometh by hearing. But I believe faith is only activated by seeing.
Alright.
I'm gonna explain. Faith is a gift from God. The Bible declares that He has dealt to every man a measure of faith. If I were to purchase a phone offline and give it to you, Brad, what would you have to do to be able to use that phone? Activate. So I could give you a gift, but it might need to be activated for work. So what happens is we need to be able to not see in the natural, because faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. But what we do need to see is in the spirit. We need to be able to see in the invisible world. Because if you can see the invisible, then you can have what you see. He tells Abraham, look
where you are. Look beyond what he's saying is, I want you to get a vision. I know you're right here, but I need you to look beyond where you are today.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, sir. Because what I want to give you is beyond where you are today. He telling me, he said, look as far as you can see.
Yeah.
And as far as you can see, that I will give to you.
Yeah.
You can have. So now we understand the importance of vision already, right? We understand the importance of being able to see beyond where we are today. Because we know God will give you what you can see. Amen. I want to define the word vision. Webster defined vision as the faculty or state of being able to see. It's the ability to think about or plan the future. It is the ability to think about or plan the future. It's a vivid mental image of what the future will or could be like.
Yes.
Vision. Do anybody have vision here? Could anybody envision life being just a little bit better? A little bit better?
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Well, if you can see it, then you can have it. Amen. Turn with me to Habakkuk 2 and 2. Little old bitty book. Turn too fast, you might pass it. Habakkuk 2 and 2. Then the Lord answered me and said, write vision, make it plain on your Samsung iPad tablet. See, God way ahead of time. Them tablets way back then. God bad. Write the vision and make it plain on your tablets, that he may run who reads it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it will speak and it will not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. See, God, he's for real ones. He didn't try to set you up to tell you, you know, you're going to get it today. You're going to get it today. He was clear. He said, make terror. He said, for a point in time. He said, because I'm strategic. I'm strategic. I'm a God of water. I'm setting some things up. I got some other stuff working over here. It's all going to work together. I'm strategic. For a point in time. It would not lie. It's just like his word. He said, he give us this parallel in Isaiah 55 where he says that the rain cometh down and the snow from heaven.
Yeah.
And the rain and the snow don't return back to heaven, but water is the earth.
Yeah.
That it may bring forth and bud.
Yeah.
That it may give seed to the soil, bread to eat. See, it don't just rain for no purpose. Not a man that he should lie. Not even the man that he
Yeah.
All right, we get some instructions here. He tells us write the vision. That's important. That's very important. Because with writing, in Matthew 4:4, someone turn it up with me, up for me, please. Let me know when you have it. Amen. Read that for me, please.
But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone.
Jesus was being, had been in the wilderness fasting 40 days, and the devil come to tempt him, and what he said is, it is written. He's showing us the power of the written word. When the enemy came up against him, he spoke about the written word because the written word has power. There's power in writing. There's power in writing. When I was preparing this message, I was writing notes. But it's kind of hard really to preach from notes. But what happens is when I'm writing, I heard it said like this, that your thoughts are organized and they pass through your lips and fingertips. When you talk a thing out, you know, you talk to people and that's, you kind of, you're not really sure, but you start talking to people and then it starts making sense to you. You start organizing your thoughts when you're writing. That's what happens. Okay, so writing is important. Writing is important. It is written. When God gave us the Ten Commandments, he did what? On tablets. Something about writing. There's something about writing. Those who journal know what I'm talking about. There's something about writing. And because he gave us the commandments and they were written, he holds us accountable. But let me show how that thing works again. His word is written. And because he's written his word to us, we can hold him accountable.
Hallelujah.
That's right. Matthew 9:20 says, "And suddenly a woman who had a flow of blood for 12 years came from behind and touched the hem of his garment." Check this out. "For she said to herself, if I may touch his garment, I shall be made well."
Okay.
What she said is really what she saw.
Yes.
I said what she said is really what she saw.
If you tell me, come, I bet y'all can walk on water.
He saw himself walking on water. You gotta see this thing. You gotta see it. You gotta see it, because what you see is what you do. He saw himself walking. He got out the boat and started walking on water.
Hallelujah.
He said, Peter. Say, Peter, you see yourself doing what I do, huh? Come on. Ain't nobody else in the boat want to take it. Come on, Peter. Nobody else in the boat want to be that courageous. Nobody else in the boat want to be that radical. Nobody else in the boat just want. Come on, Peter. They tell me, in order to see the miraculous, you got to be willing to do the ridiculous.
Brainstorming and thinking, I'm like, well, maybe if I get, a lawnmower, I can
cut some yards or something after I get off work and then kind of supplement that income.
All right.
So I came up, you know, I'm writing all this stuff down. So I started, I built me a little vision board. I didn't even know that's what it was called. You know, I'm just seeing some stuff, you know. I'm seeing my life different. I'm seeing my life better. I'm seeing myself going to be able to make it beyond just selling drugs and all that stuff. So what I would do is I would cut out a magazine. I cut a sofa out and put it in. I cut a mic away. $92 a week, part-time. I think minimum wage was $3.35 or something back then. And I held that job down for probably about 9 months. I had the job about 6 months. Christmas rolled around, wanted to get my baby something. I tried to sell drugs for about 2 weeks. Police rolled up on the bicycle. I dropped the dope, walked away. Another guy was out there with me. The police, he started knocking on the door in front of the apartment we were standing in front of, and it drew suspicion to him. And they got off the bike. They found the little box of dope on the ground, and it immediately went to him because he, when he saw him, he tried to leave and go in the house. When I saw him, I dropped the dope and walked towards him and started a conversation trying to get away from the dope. I said, I'm saying that to say this, that, you know, we talked about the vision tearing for a while and we growing weary in well doing. I was getting weary in well doing.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, sir.
But when the police rolled up on me, and I only been 6 months, I said, God, thank you, I get it. Do hard out here,
yeah.
Do bad out here,
yeah.
And then do bad in there.
Yeah.
Thank you for your grace.
Yeah. That's it.
And I got some act right.
Yeah.
I got some act right.
Yeah.
I didn't try that.
Yeah.
And a few months later, God let me get a job. Working at this mobile home plant, building mobile homes.
Okay.
And it started me out with about $9 an hour. I remember my first check, I'll bring home like $225 a week. That was a lot of money from 92.
Yeah.
93 or whatever I was making. That was a lot of money. But it was the first time for me to enact my vision. Here's what I did with my first check. First check, I went to the flea market and I bought me a lawnmower for about $75. I went to the flea market and I bought me a weed.
Yeah.
I didn't have a car. I used my sister's car. When I would get out of work at 4:30, I'm knocking on doors. Man, would you like a yard cut?
Yeah.
Man, would you like a yard cut?
Yeah.
Next year rolled around. I got my income tax check. I bought me a riding lawnmower. And had a little pimp still in my Cadillac, pulling the lawnmower behind it on the trailer. That was great, man. I remember I was at the traffic light one day, and the dude pulled up, he said, he called me Sauce. Say, Sauce, what you doing, man? And he looked at it, I got this old ragged wooden trailer and this brand new riding lawnmower pulling by this brown Cadillac. I like, dude, that back there, but you pay me on this up here. Amen. Well, when I started working that job, they had something called piece rate. They started you off on hourly, and once you learn the job, they can do it at what they call a piece rate. by how much you accomplished, not how much time you spent there. And that way I went from making like $13 to $17 an hour, something like that. You know, back then, now we talking minimum wage with $3 then, so that was making good money. I'll bring home $700, $800. I cut yards and make about another $300. I was making $1,000 legitimately, but you know what it started out with? A vision. A vision. I had a nice two-bedroom house, had a Cadillac, had a 300 VX, and I ended up buying me a pickup truck with a big commercial truck. A 300 VX sports car, Cadillac luxury car, and a pickup truck. I stand by myself. I was doing what they said could happen. I was making it, I wasn't selling dope. And I was living good. Hallelujah. I say, write the vision. I say, write the vision. Write the vision. It says make the vision plain. Make it clear. You're not confused about it. Post some pictures. See it. Make it clear to you. Focus is about clarity. When you take a camera lens and you bring it in, what you're trying to make the picture clear, because sometimes it's blurred. When you say write the vision and make it plain, focus. Make it clear. Be able to see it. Be able to understand it. So you can be able to bring it to pass. I want to say something about provision. Because a lot of time we have vision and it's hard to embrace the vision because provision becomes a problem. But provision is providing for the vision. If there is no vision, you don't need no provision. Because God provides for the vision. And some of you want provision, but you have no vision. And he provision without a vision, you're squandering. You're spending at the mall on clothes. Can I be honest? We squander what we don't have a plan for. So somebody's holding up on their provision because they had written the vision. Hallelujah. Now the lack of vision is blindness. I say the lack of vision is blindness. Turn with me to Mark 10, please. Mark 10. And we're going to look at the 46th chapter. Mark 10, the 46th verse. Well, let's go with the 46th verse. Now they came to Jericho. As he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great multitude, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the road begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Then many warned him to be quiet, but he cried all the more, son of David, have mercy on me. So Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. Then they called the blind man, saying to him, be of good cheer, rise, he is calling you. And throwing aside his garment, he rose and came to Jesus. So Jesus answered and said to him, what do you want me to do for you? The blind man said to him, Rabbi, that I may receive my sight. Then Jesus said to him, go away. Your faith has made you well. Your faith has made you well. They said that blind Bartimaeus was on the roadside. He didn't see in the natural because he couldn't see in the natural. But what happened was he had heard about Jesus. Faith coming by
hearing.
He heard about Jesus. Now, in order to activate his faith, when Jesus was passing by, Joshua saw took place. They took them. The 10 spies, what they saw took place. They did not do nothing. They didn't say we couldn't have anything. What you see, you can have. I said, what you see, you can have. Broken folks. Let me define folks. It says focus is the center of interest or activity. Focus is the center of an interest or an activity. It's an act of concentrating interest or activity. We see here's an illustration. Whenever weightlifters are getting ready to lift a lot of weight, y'all know what they do, right? They concentrate. Look at it. They size it up. They're thinking about that thing. What they're doing is they're envisioning themselves lifting. Before they come off the ground, before it come out the rack, they see it coming out of the rack.
That's it.
Concentration, the power of concentrating. Men can push heavy lumps of weight. A martial artist, if that's a word, before he get ready to break through cinder blocks or chop through stacks of wood, he concentrates. He look at it. He stare at it. He gaze at it. What he's doing, he's envisioning himself breaking through. I say he envisioning himself breaking through. From the vision, he does just that. He breaks through.
Yes.
Got out the boat, walked on water. His focus was on Jesus. Concentrated. Walking on water, concentrated focus. Broken focus, he started looking at the winds and the waves. When you break focus, things change. Focus change, activity change. It says focus is concentrated activity and interest. He stopped being interested in Jesus and interested in the stone. When he was interested in Jesus, he walked on water. When he became interested in the storm, he began to sink. Activity changed. He went from walking to sinking. Activity. When his interest changed, his activity changed.
Hallelujah.
Broken focus. Stop the Israelites from making it to the promised land. The next generation had to go in.
Hallelujah.
Wasn't because God couldn't do it, because he showed he did it anyway. You won't believe me or raise up somebody will. I said, if you won't believe me or raise up somebody will, he'll prepare the table right in your presence. He'll feed him right there in your presence. He is good for showing off in your face when you don't believe him. What they say is that it's going to rain tomorrow, this time tomorrow. You'll see, but you won't partake of it. Somebody else. nobody get your blessing. Don't let nobody have what was meant for you, because you refuse to see beyond where you are. Broken folds called you to lose strength. It prevents you from being able to break through. And it called you to be scattered, no true focus point, just kind of wandering just through life, just kind of meandering, you know, nothing half perfect. The blind man, no motivation, no reason to get dressed, get excited, get routine. He know what he gonna do. He doesn't go sit side the road, beg for some alms. Mundane, boring, life like that. Back to that vision board.
Yes.
Get that thing before you again. Get something to go after. Give you a reason to live. I'm not talking about exist. I'm talking about live. I'm talking about thrive. I'm talking about waking up excited about something. Seeing something beyond where you are today. Like just expectation. You got this spirit of expectation. You don't know how to explain. You can't quite articulate. You don't even know how it's all going to come together. But there's something inside of you that says it's going to take place. I can't shake it.
Just a little while.
When I read about the woman with issue of blood, it blessed my life. When I read about the people that were born blind and God gave them sight, it blessed my life. When I read about Job, it encourages my spirit. When I read about David, lost it all, it encourages my spirit. I'm talking about it's the people that suffer that bless my life. I don't know who bless your life, but I'm talking about somebody that went through something. You got my ear, talk to me, encourage me. But you ain't never been through nothing, you ain't suffered nothing. You keep it up, you keep it up, you. But hey, you can keep all your little cute little cliches.
sinful lust. And he's like, look, Stacy, man, you got to start getting to church on time. And, you know, you're an elder man. And, you know, people are watching. So you're supposed to be somewhat of an example. And, man, if you don't straighten up, I'm about to sit you down. But what he don't know is, like, I've been wanting to sit me down.
Yeah.
Because what he said, what you